Before you spend money on supplements or complicated diets, start here with a simple $25 glucose monitor. It's one of the easiest and most powerful ways to understand your metabolism and see exactly how your body responds to food. Your blood sugar can reveal early signs of insulin resistance. It can tell you why you feel tired after meals and even help you figure out what foods work best for your body. And once you know how to test it properly and what to look out for, the numbers start to make a lot more sense. I'm Kait, a nutritionist who helps people balance their blood sugar and reverse insulin resistance naturally. If you've seen my videos on how to reverse insulin resistance by 2026 or morning habits that keep you stuck, you know I focus on simple science-backed habits that make a big difference. And this one is at the top of the list. Today, I will show you exactly how to test your blood sugar, how to interpret your numbers, and what they mean about your health. And towards the end, I'm going to explain why your fasting blood sugar can look normal, but your insulin can be high, and how to test that too. Most people think blood sugar testing is only for diabetics, but that's not true. Your glucose pattern is like your daily report card for your metabolism. It reflects what you ate, how much you moved, how you slept, and even how stressed you were. After you eat, your pancreas releases insulin to transport the excess glucose from your bloodstream to your cells for energy. If that spike happens over and over, the body needs more and more insulin to do the same job. Your cells stop responding as well, and that is insulin resistance. Research shows that even if someone has a normal average glucose throughout the day, frequent sharp spikes and crashes are linked to more hunger, more inflammation, and higher cardiovascular risk. So patterns matter. It's not just about averages. Here's what those patterns can tell you in plain English. If your blood sugar spikes hard and fast, then crashes quickly, you're going to feel hungry, shaky, tired, or irritable an hour or two after eating. That's called reactive hypoglycemia, which is your body overcorrecting the spike. If your blood sugar rises and then stays elevated for 2 or more hours, your body is not clearing glucose efficiently. That slow return to baseline is a key sign of insulin resistance. And if your numbers are all over the place on days you slept badly, were stressed, or skipped protein, that's your physiology talking. You don't need a lab to see it. And that's why looking at fasting glucose alone isn't enough. Fasting can look fine, but your post-meal numbers can tell a completely different story. Let's get practical, because power is in the timing. The easiest and least expensive tool to start with is a simple finger prick blood glucose meter. You can pick one up from most pharmacies over the counter, or I'm gonna link to a few you can buy online in the description box down below. Here's how to do it step by step. First, test your fasting blood sugar. That means first thing in the morning before eating or drinking anything except water. This is going to give you a baseline on how your body handled glucose overnight. For many metabolically healthy adults, an ideal window often sits between 75 and 85 milligrams per deciliter, which is roughly 4.1 to 4.7 millimoles per liter. If you're a little above that, don't panic. We're looking at trends over time, not one single reading. Now, if you're above that consistently, then we already know that you have prediabetes or type 2 diabetes, depending on how high your readings are. The next time you're gonna wanna test is after meals. This is where the gold is. Take a reading right before you start eating. This is your pre-meal baseline. Then test again about 30 minutes after you finish. This helps you capture the approximate peak, especially for higher glycemic meals. Then test again at 90 minutes. And if you want to be thorough, at 120 minutes as well. That shows how fast you return to baseline. Now, here's how to interpret that data. Ideally, you don't want your peak to be more than 30 milligrams per deciliter above baseline, or about 1.6 millimoles per liter. And by 90 to 120 minutes, you definitely want to see it trending downwards towards your starting point. Now, if it's still significantly elevated 2 hours later, that suggests your body's having trouble bringing glucose down, which often points to insulin resistance. Again, you don't want to just look at one test though. You want to look at patterns over time. You can use this like a mini experiment. Try a protein forward breakfast one day, then a higher carb breakfast the next. You can also change the food order. Eat your protein, fat, and fiber first and your carbs last. Test again. Or take a 10-minute walk after a meal and see how that affects your 90-minute reading. Swap freshly cooked potatoes for ones that you let cool in the fridge and reheat it, which raises resistant starch, and then compare your peak. Small tweaks like this actually make a big difference on your blood sugar graph. And when you see that improvement, it becomes very motivating. Now, if you want deeper insights without having to prick your finger multiple times throughout the day, consider trying a continuous glucose monitor. A continuous glucose monitor, or CGM for short, gives you a 24-hour picture of how your blood sugar moves. Now, each device only lasts for 2 weeks, but that's okay because you don't need to wear one long-term. In this time, you can learn a lot about your body. You can learn how stress, sleep, coffee timing, workouts, and carb type affect you personally. Now, depending on where you live, some CGMs need a prescription, but in other countries, they're available over the counter, or there are companies that set up the prescription for you. So I'll link to some of my favorite resources for CGMs in the description box down below. Now that you know how to test, let's talk a little bit more about how to interpret what you see. If your blood sugar spikes hard and crashes fast, you probably ate fast digesting carbs without enough protein, fat, or fiber to slow things down. That big surge of insulin can overshoot and push you below baseline later, which feels like a crash. The fix is simple. Add protein, add some fat, and push your carbs a little later in the meal. Even a small starter, like a few bites of protein or green salad with olive oil, can smooth the curve. Now, if your blood sugar rises and stays elevated, then your clearance is slow. Your pancreas is releasing insulin, but your cells are not opening the door efficiently. That slow glide back to baseline is a classic insulin resistance pattern. If this is you, you want to make sure you are consistently getting 30 grams of protein at every meal. You want to be doing some exercise after you eat, and I'm not talking an intense workout, just a walk around the block, even some light housework, that can make a big difference too. This allows your body to use the energy from that meal immediately, so your blood sugar doesn't go up as high. And if you can incorporate some strength training into your routine, that's gonna help even more. Now, if your numbers are fine for breakfast, but lunch is looking a little bit wild, look at the context. Did you eat at your desk? Did you rush? Did you skip protein? Were you more stressed out later in the day? Were you sitting all afternoon? Glucose isn't just about food. There's a big picture here. Stress and sleep have a bigger impact than you might expect. Now, if you notice that your morning numbers are stubbornly high, even if you feel like you're doing everything right, you could be experiencing what is known as the dawn phenomenon. This is where cortisol rises before waking to energize your body. And this is normal, but sometimes it overshoots. The liver releases too much glucose and fasting numbers look a little bit high. Now, this often improves as overall insulin sensitivity improves with earlier dinners, protein-forward breakfasts, and consistent sleep. But for some people, caffeine on an empty stomach can be the culprit. So try pushing it back to an hour or two after you wake up. The point is, your blood sugar isn't random. Your body is trying to maintain a balance all day long. When blood sugar goes up, it's trying to bring it down. And when it drops too low, it brings it back up. Your blood sugar readings are a window into how your metabolism is functioning in real time. And they show you exactly where you need to adjust. Now, here's the tricky part. Your blood sugar can look completely normal, but you can have elevated insulin, signifying insulin resistance. As we spoke about earlier, insulin's job is to keep your glucose in range. In the early stages of insulin resistance, your body simply produces more insulin to control the same amount of glucose. So when you test your fasting blood sugar, it looks fine on paper, but insulin has been high for years behind the scenes controlling it. And this is why if you suspect you have insulin resistance, it's important to get your fasting insulin tested too. If you have symptoms like constant fatigue, stubborn belly fat, especially the hard kind, sugar cravings, skin tags in your armpits and around your neck, or a family history of diabetes, but your glucose looks normal, ask your doctor for a fasting insulin test. And if they say no, ask for a HOMA-IR test, which stands for Homeostatic Model Assessment of Insulin Resistance. This is a calculation of fasting glucose and fasting insulin that estimates insulin sensitivity. Lower numbers generally indicate better sensitivity. Now, the sad thing is a lot of doctors still don't understand the significance of testing insulin, even though it has been well demonstrated in the literature that insulin rises years before blood sugar does. And if you catch insulin resistance early and start making the necessary diet and lifestyle changes, you can prevent it from progressing to prediabetes or type 2 diabetes, even if you have a family history. Now, if your doctor still refuses, there is one option to test your fasting insulin at home. That's Sobel Health's Weight Biology Kit. This tests your fasting insulin, it tests your fasting glucose and other key biomarkers of metabolic health. It gives you your HOMA-IR score too. You do the blood sample at home, you send it back, and your results are physician reviewed. You'll receive a report within days outlining your metabolic health and letting you know next steps you can take. And I mention this as an option because early detection is important for prevention and reversal. Remember, we don't treat numbers, but we can use these numbers to make better choices. The goal is to catch a trend when it's easy to reverse. Quick question, have you ever done a blood sugar test after a meal? If you did, what did you notice? Did it spike higher than you expected? Did it stay elevated longer? Did taking a short walk help? I'm curious to hear what you've noticed from your blood sugar, so let me know in the comments down below. Now, I really want to stress that once you start testing, the point isn't to obsess. Your blood sugar doesn't need to be perfect all of the time. So here are some small tips on how to turn numbers into action. If you notice a big spike, try to eat protein and fat first, then carbohydrates. This changes gastric emptying and flattens the curve for many people. You can also add a splash of vinegar to water with a meal, or have it in a salad dressing. Acetic acid in vinegar has been scientifically proven to improve insulin sensitivity temporarily and reduce blood sugar spikes. Another thing you can try is walking for 10 or more minutes after eating. Think of this like a glucose sink. When you're exercising, your muscles pull sugar from your bloodstream without needing any insulin. Another trick is to choose whole foods over processed ones. So think eating a whole orange instead of drinking its juice. Whole foods take longer to digest and blood sugar spikes are lower. If breakfast is your worst spike, move carbs later in the day and try a protein-forward morning instead. Eggs, Greek yogurt, cottage cheese, even some leftover steak. These can all be a great breakfast choice. Now, if you're someone whose blood sugar stays high long after eating, focus on building muscle and improving insulin signaling. You can do this by strength training 2 to 4 days per week. Even short sessions make a difference. And for everyone, hit your daily protein target. This is going to support muscle protein synthesis. And of course, get enough quality sleep, have a consistent sleep and wake time, and manage your stress. Stress hormones raise glucose on their own, which can be confusing if you only look at food. And if your fasting glucose looks normal, but you feel like you have some of the signs of insulin resistance, get your insulin tested. That's the missing piece a lot of people overlook. And then they're surprised a couple years later when they get their blood sugar tested again and they're diagnosed as pre-diabetic. High insulin with normal glucose is early stage insulin resistance, and this is going to be the point where it's easier to reverse. Now, don't get me wrong, it still can be reversed when it progresses to pre-diabetes and type 2 diabetes. It's just going to be a little bit harder and might take a little bit more time. And remember, you don't need to test forever. Use a meter for a week or two and learn your patterns. And if you want deeper insights, then try a continuous glucose monitor for a couple of weeks. The goal is awareness, not hyperfixation, not anxiety. This is a tool. These are just numbers. Yes, we can learn from them, but our numbers don't have to be perfect. When you act on this data, you're going to feel more energized. You're going to have fewer cravings and your health is going to improve. And this is one way to become an expert on your own body. You don't have to guess what works. Your numbers will tell you. And if you're ready for the next step, make sure to check out my video on how to reverse insulin resistance by 2026. In that video, I talk more about specific foods to eat and how to build habits to improve insulin sensitivity, which is going to help to control your blood sugar better.